What is it you wanted me to reconcile myself to? I was born here almost 60 years ago. I'm not going to live another 60 years. You always told me it takes time. It has taken my father's time, my mother's time, my uncle's time, my brother's and my sister's time, my niece's and my nephew's time. How much time do you want for your progress?
Because, you see, so many of our ancestors was killed because we have never accepted slavery. We had to live on it, but we've never wanted it. So we know that this flag is drenched with our blood. So what the young people are saying now, give us a chance to be young men, respected as a man, as we know this country was built on the black backs of black people across this country. And if we don't have it, you ain't gonna have it either, because we gonna tear it up. That's what they're saying. And people ought to understand that. I don't see why they don't understand that. They know what they've done to us. All across this country, they know what they've done to us.
Well, Gee, what's up, boss? How you doing, man?
DeMarcus Cousins, huge NBA star, plays for New Orleans Pelicans right now, is from Alabama. Both New Orleans and where he's from in Alabama are both going through different issues with Confederate statues. We ask him, we say,
do you think they should take all those Confederate statues down?
Hell yeah.
And you're from Alabama, you know?
Do you take all the
He's speaking out, Kevin Durant.
Should the Confederate monuments on the grounds of the state capitol stay, or should they go? It's a question before the North Carolina Historical Commission.
CBS North Carolina political reporter Bo Minnick is live with why North Carolinians will have to wait another 7 months before they can get an answer to that question. Bo?
Sean, the State Historical Commission says it needs to wait and learn more before making a decision about what to do with monuments like the one that you see here. The board postponed its decision until April. This comes after a request from Governor Cooper's administration. He wants to see those monuments moved to the Bentonville battlefield in Johnston County. The reason that this is before the State Historical Commission is a state law passed in 2015 that allows the commission to move objects of remembrance, like Confederate monuments, when appropriate measures are taken to preserve them, and there also needs to be a reason for the move, for example, making room for construction.
We're really not used to, as a body, having issues that are this deep and this problematic coming before us in such a short period of time.
We need to have a robust discussion on that, and I think that's something perhaps the commission members could have initiated today.
Mission from
Dr.
Commission.
David Denard, who you just heard from there, an ECU history professor, is the lone board member who voted against delaying the decision. The commission says that it's going to seek further legal clarification about exactly what authority it has to address this matter.
Sister Kim Weston, the Black National Anthem.
Lift every voice and sing. Hope that the present has brought us, facing the
We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. And I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
The only way to end the cycle of violence is to address the root of it, which is systemic racism. My name is Bree Newsom. I came to national recognition when I scaled the flagpole at Columbia, South Carolina, and lowered the Confederate flag.
You come against me with hatred and oppression and violence. I come against you in the name of God.
I think the fight over Confederate monuments and flags and symbols, it's really about a battle of ideology and an understanding of history. These monuments symbolize slavery and systemic racism. And so when people are going back and forth over how these monuments should be displayed or if they should be displayed at all, what we're really debating is our history of slavery and our present reality of systemic racism. We have to remember, segregation was the law of the land until just 50 years ago, and even though it's not the law of the land, it's still very much a social practice. Many of our institutions are as segregated today as they were before the Civil Rights Movement.
You're not born to hate! None of us are born to hate!
The neo-Nazis and the white supremacists, they see an ally in the White House. They see allies in the police force. They see allies in the entire power structure. And they're not entirely wrong in that.
I'm coming down. I'm prepared to be arrested.
I was on the news the other day and the banner read, Bree Newsom illegally removed flag in South Carolina. And, you know, my first thought was, well, you know, when Rosa Parks was arrested for refusing to give up her seat, that was also illegal. You know, we forget that laws can be unjust, and that's why civil disobedience is an important and vital part of democracy.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
I hope that we don't see the same level of violence that we saw in the past, but one thing that is really concerning to me is
good evening. Today, in the shadow of the South Carolina State House, it took an honor guard just 36 seconds to lower a symbol that has divided this nation for a century and a half. The applause was thunderous and sustained. Look at the crowd. After 54 years, the Confederate battle flag was brought down from the site for the very last time. It was a swift and dramatic turn in history, born of the racist murders of 9 members of a black church in Charleston less than a month ago by a man who embraced that flag. Tonight we have 2 reports. Ron Allen starts us off from Columbia. Ron, good evening.
Good evening, Lester. All that remains of the Confederate flag here now is the concrete slab behind that monument on the ground that the flag pole used to stand in. A flag that for more than 50 years, as one editorial writer put it, signaled to about a third of the state's population, the black population, that they did not matter and that there was absolutely nothing they could do about it. Now, today, largely because of the massacre at Mother Emanuel Church in Charleston, South Carolina took that flag down.
A massive outburst of emotion as South Carolina brought down one of the most divisive symbols in the nation. As many as 10,000 jamming the streets around the statehouse for a dignified 6-minute ceremony there to bear witness.
New chapter in South Carolina's history.
Many wiped away tears, including Governor Nikki Haley. An epic moment that happened, many believe, because 9 innocent souls were massacred in their church, and their relatives have shown grace and forgiveness.
It's hard to put closure to what has happened to my sister, but I'm making it.
Claudette Coakley Watkins lost her sister, Myra Thompson.
I tell you, Myra would be in heaven smiling on what's being done down here on earth. I know she is.
Members of the Honor Guard, perhaps ironically, the same men who carried the body of slain state senator and pastor Clemente Pinckney, Lieutenant Derek Gamble carried the banner away.
What did you feel while you were doing that?
Well, again, like I said, just a sense of honor and knowing that the people of South Carolina has come together to make this happen.
The flag was taken to a military museum that houses Confederate and other military memorabilia. 25,000 visitors a year. A multi-million dollar display will be built for the flag, part of the deal lawmakers made to bring it down. Later, workers took down the flagpole and the fence around it too, as on this occasion that no one would have predicted until the Mother Emanuel murders, South Carolina celebrated what many are calling the dawn of a new day.
USA! USA!
Ron Allen, NBC News, Columbia, South Carolina.
My name is Reverend Clemente Pinckney, and as of a couple of weeks ago, I'm in my fourth year of pastoring here at the church, and along with pastoring here at Mother Emanuel, since the year 2000, it's been my privilege to serve the people in South Carolina Senate District 45 in the state legislature. Where you are is a very special place in Charleston, and it's a very special place because this church and this site, this area, has been tied to the history and life of African Americans since about the early 1800s. This church was built in 1891. The congregation was formed in 1818. And for those of you who may know a little something about our denomination, we started in 1787 through our founder, Richard Allen, who left then St. George's Methodist Episcopal Church because they were telling him he needed to pray after the regular members prayed. And so that's how the denomination began, in a fit of civil disobedience and a little issue with theological fairness, if you will. What our church and denomination stands for is really, it stands for the universal vision of all people being treated fairly under the law as God sees us in his sight. And so we welcome you here today. We have a great host of leaders here from the Charleston area, and we would love to just engage with you, answer questions, and to hear your thoughts. Would it be appropriate if I ask if we could bow our heads for a word of prayer in the sanctuary? God, we welcome and invite you into this place, your house. We thank you for the spirit that dwells here, the spirit of Denmark Vesey, the spirit of R. H. Kane, the spirit of Dr. King, the spirit of many of the unsung heroes of our people. But we also thank you, God, for all persons who come seeking to expand their horizons and seeking to learn more about what our country is made of and what makes us who we are as a people and as a country. We pray for safe travels for all who are here and for the safe return of them as they go back home. We pray that our time here spent today will be seen as an act of love as well as an act of righteous indignation in the face of injustices. And we pray that all persons here today may feel your presence and be drawn closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. In a nutshell, you can say that the African American church, and in particular in South Carolina, really has seen it as its responsibility and its ministry and its calling to be fully integrated and caring about the lives of its constituents and the general community. We don't see ourselves, or many of us don't see ourselves, as just a place where we come and worship, but as a beacon and as a bearer of the culture and a bearer of what makes us a people. But I like to say that this is not necessarily unique to us. It's really what America is all about. Could we not argue that America is about freedom, whether we live it out or not? But it really is about freedom, equality, and the pursuit of happiness. And that's what churches are all about. Freedom to worship and freedom from sin, freedom to be full what God intends us to be, and to have equality in the sight of God. And sometimes you got to make noise to do that. Sometimes you may have to die like Denmark Vesey to do that. Sometimes you have to march and struggle and be unpopular to do that. And I'm sure.
Reactions to the Confederate flag today reached into state capitals across the South. The governors of Virginia and North Carolina both call for taking the flag off special order license plates. U.S. Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell of Kentucky said a statue of Jefferson Davis, the president of the Confederacy, should be taken out of that state's Capitol rotunda. And in Mississippi, the Speaker of the State House called for the removal of the Confederate emblem from the state flag. We use this moment to take a look at the South of today with Russell Moore, who is the president of the Southern Baptist Convention's Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission. Jack Hunter is a radio host and blogger in South Carolina who has used the identity of the Southern Avenger. And from Atlanta is Isabel Wilkerson. She's the Pulitzer Prize-winning author of The Warmth of Other Suns, about Southern Black migration, and we welcome all three of you to the program. Russell Moore, let me start with you. What role does the Confederate flag play in the identity of the South today, do you believe?
Well, I think the Confederate battle flag is a symbol that causes a great deal of division and reminds us of a really hurtful legacy in past. And I think people see it in different ways. And I think what some people see in the Confederate flag is a sense of Southern assertion that the South matters. So, for instance, I was at a conference one time where, as the speaker, every time that he would reference someone saying something ignorant, would do it in a Southern accent. I think there's some Southerners, black and white, who feel as though the rest of the country looks down on the South as uneducated and backward. And for some people, that was a symbol of defiance against that. But it's really clear that the way the Confederate battle flag has been used, not only initially in terms of the Confederate States of America, but in our more recent history, in terms of terrorist acts against African Americans, that this is a symbol that causes unnecessary division.
Jack Hunter, you wrote yesterday that you used to believe that it was possible to think of the Confederate flag not having to do with racism, but you no longer think that's possible. Why is that? Why have you changed?
Well, because it's not possible, first of all, but that's the mistake that a lot of Confederate flag defenders make. Part of what Russell was saying, they say it's about states' rights. They say it's about heritage. They say it's about everything you could possibly imagine that's honorable and good and decent, while ignoring this vast history of racial terrorism, from slavery to the Ku Klux Klan to Jim Crow to a deranged man walking into a church in my hometown of South Carolina and murdering 9 people in cold blood for the color of their skin. All that's associated with the Confederate flag. I think this is sort of a wake-up call for the nation and the South, and maybe Charleston, you know, where this all started, that symbol does not mean to most Americans what it means to the people who admire it most. And the people who do admire it are probably smaller than ever, and the people who feel negatively toward the Confederate flag are probably larger than ever. It's time to move on. It's time for the flag to come down, because it just doesn't represent who we are as a people, as Americans anymore.
Isabel Wilkerson, I wouldn't, of course, ask you to speak for all African Americans in the South, but how have you, your family members, people close to you, how have you looked upon the Confederate symbol?
Well, as your other guests have indicated, it's a symbol of subjugation. It's a symbol of pain and terror for generations. I think many people in our country, we don't think about how long this institution was in place. It was in place for 12 generations. I mean, imagine how many greats you would have to add to grandparent in order to cover that many families generation after generation. And so this is something that African Americans are still dealing with to this day. When you think about just the very basic effort to try to trace one's genealogy, you come to a stop as an African American in this country, for most African Americans, when it comes to enslavement. And that's how African Americans still deal with this to this day. This is actually quite real and very personal for many people.
Russell Moore, what do you think it means if the flag is no longer going to be a prominent or even a partial symbol of the history of the South, the story of the Confederacy?
Well, I don't think that the story goes away. We have to remember our past sins as well as our past glories as a region and as a country. What I do think it means is that the South recognizes now, starting to recognize now, the darkness of some of that past, and also the fact that the South doesn't just include white people. Southerners, to say that one is a Southerner does not simply mean that one is a white Southerner. We have great diversity in the South. And so we care a lot about family in the South. And I think what's happening is not that we're kicking anybody out of the family reunion. We're saying that Robert E. Lee is part of our story, but so is Fannie Lou Hamer. And Stonewall Jackson is part of our story, but so is Martin Luther King. And I think that's an important development, one that we should encourage.
Jack Hunter, is it possible to still appreciate the history, or to have any appreciation of the history, the heritage, of the role of the Confederacy, and at the same time try to have an idea that is, frankly, that honors today the role that African Americans play in the South?
Sure, and those have coexisted for a long time. The question is, what sort of treatment should they receive that is more respectful to the majority? Sort of coming from that background where I defended that symbol for so many years, I think it's such a shame that people are so much more worried about being right than being decent. And that's what a lot of this comes down to. They want to be right. They want to make their point about what happened on a certain historical date, and you don't understand this. I would, tell anybody today, if my fellow white Southerners who still defend that symbol, you don't have the right to tell a black American that they don't understand what that symbol means. It means something different to them than it means to you. And I think that's part of the conversation we're seeing in Charleston right now.
But you believe that's changing.
I do. I think it's for the better. It won't be overnight, but I think this might be a historical moment right now, what we're seeing. This tragedy, if there's a silver lining. I mean, I'm from Charleston, South Carolina. I was very happy but not shocked to see people coming together in my hometown, and I think maybe we can do that as a nation. I think we're changing the national conversation.
Isabel Wilkerson, what do you see when you look at the South and you begin to take the Confederacy clearly it's part of the history, but when you take honoring the Confederacy, you begin to take that out of the South and the picture of the South today.
Well, I think we're at a karmic moment for the South, but for our country as a whole. You think about the last 4 years in which, historically speaking, we've been commemorating the sesquicentennial of the Civil War. South Carolina was the first state to secede from the Union in the months leading up to the war. South Carolina was where the first shots were fired. And then this past week, the massacre at Mother Emanuel AME Church occurred on the night before Juneteenth, which is a sacred day for African Americans, the day when the last enslaved people were set free in Texas, which was 2.5 years after the Emancipation Proclamation. So this history is inescapable, and it seems as if we are coming full circle. And the history, and as it's playing itself out, even now, seems to be inevitable.
Russell Moore, for those who say, but as you, I think you pointed out a minute ago, what happened during the Civil War, the Confederacy, is a part of Southern history. What do you say to those who say, well, I don't want to forget that? It's still there.
Well, I think we can remember our past without valorizing parts of our past that we ought to see as wrong. I heard someone say that concern over the flag is sensitivity to microaggressions. To which my response is to say that kidnapping and enslaving people, breaking up families, terrorizing families, if that's not a macro aggression, I don't know what is. And the battle flag symbolizes that, and symbols matter. Remember the debate that we had several years ago about burning the American flag. Burning an American flag does something. It communicates something. And so I think we can remember our history. We have to. Or else we will fall right back into the same patterns. But to do so in a way that understands that we come from a fallen people, all of us. And as a Christian, the biggest problem with my family tree is not Jefferson Davis, it's Adam. I believe that we're all created in the image of God, and we're all fallen sinners. And I think we can recognize that as we look backward in history.
Jack Hunter, how should the rest of the country look upon the South now?
Right now, they should look at us with some optimism. I mean, I can't think of a tide change on this issue, anything even remotely close to it in the last few decades. And I think that's encouraging. I think that more Southerners than ever are understanding that this symbol does not represent the country, doesn't represent the region in the way it should. That does not mean you can't honor your ancestors who fought for a particular battle that is important. That does not mean that, but it does mean that you cannot say this symbol represents everyone. I think that's what people are seeing happening in the South today.
And Isabel Wilkerson, the rest of the country, how should they be looking at the South right now?
I think the South is, we should remember, a vital and important part of the rest of the country. And the country looks to the South, one would hope, for hopefully answers to how to deal with this enduring ancient question, these tensions and conflicts that have cast a cloud over us for so long. It would just be so wonderful if the answers could actually come from the South itself.
We thank you all three for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
In response to the horrible shooting death of the 9 members of a church in South Carolina, the Southern Poverty Law Center is going to launch a program. We're calling it Erasing Hate. There are numerous government-sponsored symbols of the Confederacy that are out in the public across this nation that, quite frankly, it's time that they be removed. We want to identify, with your help, these symbols of hate that are across this nation and bring pressure on local governments to remove them. And with your help, we hope to have a brighter day and future in this country where we'll have more acceptance and tolerance among all of our people. Thank you so much.
In 2015. Oh, you can see what's happening right now. It looks like
Black Lives Matter! Black Lives Matter! Black Lives Matter!
From the South Carolina State House in 2015. Oh, you can see what's happening right now. It looks like both sides of the crowd are fighting one another.
This flag comes down today.
It means a lot to me to honor my ancestors that stood up and
fought for what they believed in.
It represents white supremacy, and I have to fight that.
If you look on this side, the man who has the Confederate flag, the stick in which the pole that the flag is on has been broken.
The dark of night, workers in helmets and tactical vests tearing down a Confederate memorial in New Orleans. Security so tight, police snipers looked on from surrounding rooftops.
We are across elated that this monument is coming down. But again, we say that this is a cowardice, that this is happening in the middle of the night.
The Liberty Monument was an obelisk dating back to 1891. High McHenry says it honored his great-grandfather.
It's an egregious attack on history. This is the history of our area. You can't change it by pulling down monuments.
But Mayor Mitch Landrieu says the statue is offensive, once used as a rallying point for the Ku Klux Klan.
We will no longer allow the Confederacy to literally be put on a pedestal in the heart of our city.
It's the first of four monuments set to be taken down throughout the city, part of a southern state trend to move Confederate symbols to museums after the 2015 massacre of 9 black churchgoers in Charleston, South Carolina. The New Orleans majority black city council voted to remove these statues that year, but legal battles slowed the process until now.
They silently stoked the flames of racial hostility. That's the price to keep them up. I say it's better for us to take them down, and then we can move forward into the 21st century.
City officials say they've gotten death threats, so the mayor won't say when the other monuments will come down. Tonight, the Big Easy is struggling with a difficult past. Gabe Gutierrez, NBC News.
Hey, NBC News.
An excited crowd after the Robert E. Lee Monument, the fourth and last statue, came down Friday evening. After hours of prepping, crews lowered the statue down to the circle.
Hopefully, we can figure out a way to unify the city in another way.
A process that the city expected to end at 5 p.m. ended up going an hour longer.
Hey, let's go!
And just after 6, a familiar part of the city's skyline looked drastically different.
A monument is a celebration of something, and I don't think that we want to celebrate people that defended slavery.
A small crowd stayed to see the crews drive off with the monument. It made its way out of Lee's Circle around 7:30, making a right turn under the Pontchartrain Expressway and out of sight.
The Confederacy was on the wrong side of history. There was a civil war. The South lost. They fought for a cause that was to deny the humanity to millions of our American citizens, and that is the history, and it's not going to change. What has changed, though, is that the city of New Orleans is no longer revering that cause as though it was the just cause and the right cause. We have spent the last 12 years rebuilding our city, and as we look forward to our 300th anniversary,
the people of the city started thinking about building the city back, not necessarily the way it was, but the way it could have been if we would have gotten it right the first time. And as we started thinking about our public spaces, those Confederate monuments really stuck out as a really not a accurate recitation of who New Orleans had ever been.
The white mayor of this predominantly black town says keeping these symbols of the Confederacy on a pedestal is out of step with today's values.
These monuments celebrate a fictional sanitized Confederacy, ignoring the death, ignoring the enslavement, ignoring the terror that it actually stood for. And after the Civil War, these monuments were part of that terrorism, as much as burning a cross on someone's lawn. They were erected purposefully to send a strong message to all who walked in the shadows about who was still in charge in this city. It's about remembering the totality of New Orleans history and reflecting who we are as a people and having public spaces that reflect us all. You can't talk about that without talking about race, and race is a very hard issue for lots of people to talk to. I didn't start the Civil War. I didn't start the problems with race in this country, but I did force the people of New Orleans to confront them. We believe that diversity is a strength, it's not a weakness. When you bring lots of different people together, you form new things like jazz. There are other places that may have a different opinion about that, but that was New Orleans' feeling. And to the extent that that's reflective of what some other cities may think or instructive, then, you know, we hope that they learn from us both positively and negatively from this experience.
Good morning, Charlie. So this statue of Robert E. Lee was put up nearly 100 years ago. But here, as in other cities across the South, these Confederate symbols now are at the center of a bitter debate about how we define our past as we move forward as a nation.
They're relics of a painful past, memorials to a war, generals whose names are etched in history. Stonewall Jackson, Robert E. Lee.
We must go! We must go!
But now there are new battlegrounds, from Charlottesville to New Orleans. Confederate monuments have been vandalized, and some cities have voted to remove them, all part of a public debate over whether these statues memorialize racism.
But symbolism matters.
When you say symbolism matters, that's a symbol of what?
It's a symbol, in my personal opinion, white supremacy, and it's a symbol that we cannot have in the middle of our city.
Charlottesville City Councilman Wes Bellamy has led the fight to move the town's statue of Robert E. Lee. But opponents, led by attorney Charles Weber, argue the statue symbolizes something else.
These are war memorials that exist for one purpose, to honor the men who fought. It's not to promote a cause of the war. It's not to glorify war. It's to honor the men who fought.
Weber points to a Virginia law, similar to others across the South, that blocks cities and towns from removing war memorials.
This statue could never be moved. It has to stay here.
Yes.
Forever.
Yes.
Even though many people find this terribly offensive.
Offensive is a way to stop a conversation about the meaning of the statue. All right, it's not a way to start the conversation.
University of South Carolina professor Thomas Brown studies Confederate symbols.
There are hundreds of these across the landscape of the South. The controversies over removal of monuments are partly over, well, who is going to decide exactly what that public space is going to endorse?
For years, these fights focused on the Confederate flag, which largely has disappeared from public spaces, a reflection of changing attitudes. The opposition to change runs deep and can turn personal.
We've seen there's still a lot of issues in regards to race here in this community, and the only way for us to move forward is to deal with them head on.
Now, while this legal fight continues, city officials here in Charlottesville will review a plan next week with recommendations on where to put this 28-foot statue if it's ever allowed to be moved, a problem other cities across the South are likely to have to face. Nora?
Jan, thank you. It's an important story. It's going to spark a lot of debate.
George Washington was a slave owner. Was George Washington a slave owner? So will George Washington now lose his status? Are we going to take down statues to George Washington? How about Thomas Jefferson? What do you think of Thomas Jefferson? You like him? Okay, good. Are we going to take down the statue? Because he was a major slave owner. Now, are we going to take down his statue? So you know what? It's fine. You're changing history. You're changing culture.
Clearly a man who's never read a history book, Donald Trump doubling down on white supremacy. His stance is not stopping the efforts to remove Confederate statues all over the country. Just yesterday, the Lexington, Kentucky City Council took steps to remove two statues sitting near the courthouse. Right now, there are 718 monuments and statues across the U.S. Virginia has the most at 96, followed by North Carolina and Georgia with 90 each. Since Dylan Roof massacred nine people and blind black folks in Charleston, South Carolina in 2015, only nine cities have removed or in the process of removing their statues. More than 60 publicly funded symbols have been removed or renamed since the mass shooting. North Carolina Governor Roy Cooper penned an article on the website Medium.com calling for removing all Confederate statues from state government property. His letter comes after college students in Durham, North Carolina pulled down a Confederate statue. Durham County deputies arrested Takia Thompson after she wrapped a rope around the statue to help protesters pull it down. Authorities are planning to arrest more protesters involved in removing the statue. Overnight, literally 5 hours ago, the city of Baltimore removed at least two Confederate statues. Republican Maryland Governor Larry Hogan is demanding the Roger Taney statue be removed from the State House in Annapolis, Maryland. Taney was the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court who wrote the dreadful Dred Scott decision, allowing slave owners to bring slaves into Western territories. In a statement, Governor Hogan said, quote, "While we cannot hide from our history, nor should we, the time has come to make clear the difference between properly acknowledging our past and glorifying the darkest chapters of our history. I believe removing the Justice Robert B. Taney statue from the State House grounds is the right thing to do." There are also plans to remove, again, as I said, statues in Baltimore. Before ordering the removal of four Confederate statues in New Orleans, Mayor Mitch Landrieu gave a passionate speech about why this issue is about more than statues.
These statues are not just stone and metal. They're not just innocent remembrances of a benign history. These monuments celebrate a fictional sanitized Confederacy, ignoring the death, ignoring the enslavement, ignoring the terror that it actually stood for. And after the Civil War, these monuments were part of that terrorism, as much as burning a cross on someone's lawn. They were erected purposefully to send a strong message to all who walked in the shadows about who was still in charge in this city.
This sentiment didn't sit well with former Republican House Speaker Newt Gingrich. He's accusing mayors of pandering to black folks by removing the Confederate statues.
Mayors in towns that are largely black are going to pander to their audience. They're going to go out and prove they're popular by doing something that meets the current demagogic needs. But that's everything the Founding Fathers worried about.
Yes, the same Founding Fathers who were slave owners, the same Founding Fathers who did not include black folks in the Constitution, the same Founding Fathers who declared three-fifths of American. Those are the same Founding Fathers, Newt Gingrich. Go sit the hell down. Lexington Mayor Jim Gray joins me now via FaceTime to discuss his decision to remove the statues. Mayor Gray, when you listen to the Newt Gingrich of the world, he basically is saying that folks like you are just trying to appease black folks.
Yeah, I heard him. I was just shaking my head rolling. You know, when you look at this issue, let me tell you a little bit about our story here. These statues, the two that we're looking at today, that we're asking to be relocated, the two, they're standing on sacred ground. It was once the Cheapside auction block. It was one of the largest auction blocks and sites in the South. Now, it's just not right that these two men that fought to preserve slavery are still standing on the same ground that men and women and children were auctioned into slavery. That was my decision, that just wasn't right. And, you know, I've been asked, you know, well, why did you do it now? And why did you announce it on Saturday? Well, we were already planning to do it. I was planning to put it before the city council yesterday, which is what I did. And when the events emerged in Charlottesville, it just reinforced my decision that this is the right thing to do.
And when you listen to 45 yesterday, I'm sorry, Mayor, I cannot call this man president. When you listen to him say, well, you know, what's next? It is as if he's oblivious to the fact that these monuments were not erected after the Civil War. They were erected more than two generations later by white races, the Redeemers on the Democratic side, the Lily White Movement on the Republican side, because they wanted to change history. He says we're changing history. No, we're telling the actual truth.
Yeah, you're telling, and that's what we're saying here. Let's tell the actual truth. You know, if we'd actually, you know, there is the argument, you know, let's learn from history. But if we'd learn from history, then these statues would have been relocated and taken away from the center of our city and the center of our justice system a long time ago, if we'd learned from history.
Well, Mayor Gray, I thank you for your leadership, and I also hope other mayors follow your lead, and hopefully your state senator, Mitch McConnell, and Rand Paul will stand with you on this and not run from this issue.
I appreciate you having me on the show, Roland. Thank you.
Mayor, thanks a lot.
Weekdays on TV One.
My name is Robert Lee IV. I'm a descendant of Robert E. Lee, the Civil War general whose statue was at the center of violence in Charlottesville. We have made my ancestor an idol of white supremacy, racism, and hate. As a pastor, it is my moral duty to speak out against racism, America's original sin. Today, I call on all of us with privilege and power to answer God's call to confront racism and white supremacy head on. We can find inspiration in the Black Lives Matter movement, the women who marched in the Women's March in January, and especially Heather Heyer, who died fighting for her beliefs in Charlottesville.
What I think that you folks and the mayor are getting right is, and the president is getting wrong, is this very simple fact. Lee, for example, is on that horse, on that statue, on that high plinth, and on that hill in Charlottesville, precisely because he led the military side of a movement for treason on behalf of slavery. When we put George Washington on a statue, we don't put him on there because he was a slave owner. We put him on there despite the fact that he was a slave owner. We put him on there because he led the United States Armed Forces during the Revolutionary War. We put him on there because he was the first president. We put him on there because he did a really good, made a really good gesture, followed by, among others, Nelson Mandela, by resigning his presidency after two terms instead of trying to stay on forever. There's a lot of good things that George Washington did that we are trying to honor. Same for, I'm not a big fan of Thomas Jefferson, but the same thing for Thomas Jefferson. There's no doubt that when we honor Jefferson Davis and Robert E. Lee and so on, it's precisely because they led a movement on behalf of slavery, on behalf of white supremacy. And to honor them for that is the problem. Now, these people who are saying, well, aren't you erasing history? The answer to that is very simple. The statue of Robert E. Lee doesn't even tell any history. It just tells two things. He was a great man, and we honor him. It doesn't even say on it that he led the Confederacy, you know, in terms of what it tells. If you take him down And you just put up a historical marker saying, right here, there was a statue of Robert E. Lee. It was put up during the nadir of race relations, 1923 or 4, I think it was, right in the middle of the most white supremacist era in our thinking in the entire past. And it came down in, let's say, 2018, if it takes until next spring.
Right.
And here's why it came down. Then you're telling history on this historical marker. There's no erasure of history. There's an erasure of the love and admiration and respect that we are currently giving Lee by having him up there.
It is illegal in Germany to name anything after Nazis.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Yet we have streets. We have schools,
army bases.
We have facilities,
right.
Army bases named after what I call domestic terrorists and folks who committed treason.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Isn't it amazing? I mean, if I were African American and did my basic training in Fort Hood, or in Fort Bragg, or any of the other 11 in all army bases, they're not only named for. Confederate generals. In at least two cases, they're named for really bad ones who lost almost every battle they ever got in, so it's not as if we're honoring them for their military prowess. Mm-hmm. But they also, if you just read what some of these people argued and said in the 1860s, it's astounding. I mean, it's so racist we wouldn't even... It would be hard to put it into a high school history textbook. People would think, well, you're inciting to riot.
No, man,
and then we name things for them.
And then Robert E. Lee surrendered. At Appomattox, he urged all of his followers to furl this flag. And in one statement, he said, put it in your attics. He didn't want this flag flown at his funeral. He didn't want to be buried in his Confederate uniform because he said this was a symbol and the uniform's a dress for treason.
That was South Carolina Congressman Jim Clyburn in 2015 explaining why the Confederate flag should not fly at government buildings. Now, let's continue to talk about these flags and the symbols. Of course, we talk with our panel here as well. We talk with historian and author James Lowen. James, you said in the break that you have another solution.
Yeah, I think all these Confederate monuments need to go in one place. This is kind of what Hungary did. This is kind of what Russia did with all their monuments to Lenin, Stalin, and the local communist leaders in each country and in each place. Charlottesville, it turns out, has something like four or five of them if you count them all. And they could go into one park and it could be called the Nadir Park. That's N-A-D-I-R. And this means, this is an English language word, a lot of people don't know it, meaning low point. And the meaning of it is, we had in this country what's called the nadir of race relations. This is the period from 1890 to about 1940, when racism actually got worse and worse. White folks in their ideology went more racist than even they did during slavery time. I can explain that if you want. And things got worse. Now, this doesn't fit with how we usually teach American history. And I know because I wrote this book, Lies. My teacher told me I'm the only American ever to have read 18 high school history textbooks. It damn near killed me, too. And they all tell this story. And this story means we started out great, and we've been getting better and better and better and better, kind of automatically ever since. But in race relations, around 1890, we started getting worse.
That's when the Redeemers came in.
And that's when the statues went up.
Right.
And so these statues need to express that by being put into a nadir park that would really teach, most Americans don't even know the word, that would teach Americans that things do go get worse sometimes and did get worse that time. And here are some actual artifacts that show how worse they got, if I can say it that way. And that would be a useful use of these darn things. Wouldn't tear them down. Some of them are very good statues artistically. They'd still be there, but they would be in a teaching context. They'd all be in one place, just like all the communist ones in Budapest.
And again, a lot of the Charlottesville, I'm not gonna call it a protest. Greg Carr,
yes,
was in front of the Robert E. Lee statue.
Yes, sir.
This is what Robert E. Lee, first of all, who wasn't from Virginia, this is what he said. This is Robert E. Lee.
Yes.
I think it wiser, moreover, not to keep open the sores of war, but to follow the examples of those nations who endeavored to obliterate the marks of civil strife and to commit to oblivion the feelings it engendered. This is what conservative Rich Lowry wrote in the New York Post. The statues have often been part of an effort to whitewash the Confederacy, and it's one thing for a statue to be merely a resting place for pigeons, it's another for it to be a fighting cause for neo-Nazis. Lee himself opposed building Confederate monuments in the immediate aftermath of the war. Again, and then that particular quote, I think it wiser not to keep open the sores of war. Greg. Right.
Well, I'd say this very quickly. Remember, Robert E. Lee went to West Point, and shout out to the young sister who's the first African-American woman to be the captain at West Point now. But Lee went to school with General Howard, Oliver Howard. These guys sided up, they fought, and then Lee lost. So he realized we lost, so we have to bury this. I would encourage everybody to go to C-SPAN and look at the all-night debate over the Confederate flag that the South Carolina legislature had a couple of years ago. And you see this thing come out. Professor Lowen, you made a very interesting couple of suggestions, I think. But the question becomes, what happens when you put all that stuff in one place? Now we've got a revised curriculum, the work that you've been doing, the work that you all are doing. Now we've got to attack policy. But Roland, I think you put it right where it needs to be, brother. Just like they argued at the South Carolina legislature in that all-night debate, this stuff has to be put somewhere where it will transform this country. We have another chance to transform this country. And as you put in your editorial there, that call to charge, this is a revolution, and everybody better be on the right side of history.
That's right. Liz.
Yeah, these symbols, these statutes are a reminder of our oppression, and anyone who can argue that it's important for us to maintain that is wrong. There's no way to get around that. And as you pointed out, you know, these neo-Nazis and racists are just dumb. They're standing out there trying to support something that a person who did not want separatists to continue. He spoke out. Robert Lee spoke out about keeping those symbols alive, was keeping the division alive after the Civil War. They're so stupid, and it's disheartening to think that anyone would support their attempt in our president to say that they had a permit, as if that gives them the authority or the right to behave in that manner, to support someone who didn't want them to support a statute for him.
Wendy, it is because, again, I need people to understand, our American education system purposely has lied. Our American education system was infiltrated by the same people who put these statues up. They don't want the truth. You see the effort today in Texas and in Tennessee to lie about what actually took place. They don't want people to know the actual truth.
It's not. And these monuments are not about history. These monuments are about hatred. And we need to make that very clear. And I'm so glad you brought up the education system, because as an educator, you see, when we talk about black and brown students, we always use this deficit language, at risk, low income. It permeates throughout our society and into our educational system. And I just want to bring up a point just to show you how history repeats itself, even when history is so close. Takiyah Thompson, the person who took down this Confederate statue, who was a part of it, she was arrested.
How about that? North Carolina Central University.
Now, let me tell you something. And Durham, North Carolina is my hometown.
And the folk.
DeAndre.
Those guys who beat DeAndre Harris.
Right. Nobody
have yet to be arrested.
Come on now.
But the person who took down the, y'all were quick to arrest this woman. But we have on video eight people beating up DeAndre Harris, and no one has been arrested. We have a problem. Our society has a problem. And if you don't believe it, look at what has happened after these events. I'm upset. I'm sorry. I just can't deal. I can't deal, because it's too much. It's too much, and we allow this to happen, and it's not right.
James, real quick, before I got to go to a break, there has to be a massive realignment and re-education of Americans when it comes to our history and our books about the real story of America.
Well, let me say this. I've gone around America for the last 10 years. I get teaching and speaking engagements all across the country, usually by school systems, so I'm talking to teachers. And I have found that 60 to 65% of all teachers in my huge audiences say the following. When I ask what was the number one cause for secession, they say states' rights. That is 180 degrees wrong. Wow. The South seceded for slavery and against states' rights, and they name which states and which rights really upset them. So the idea that they seceded for states' rights is another creation of this terrible.
Precisely. It was done on purpose.
Yes.
But if you go back and read the original document from South Carolina, secession was about slavery.
That's right.
There's absolutely no question about it.
Listen to how this textbook describes slavery.
The master often had a barbecue or a picnic for his slaves. Then they had a great frolic. Even while working in the cotton fields, they sang songs. The beat of the music and the richness of their voices made work seem light.
Yikes, that's from History of Georgia, a textbook published in 1954 that was taught across junior high schools in Georgia for decades. That sort of language is part of an intellectual movement called the Lost Cause, a distorted version of American Civil War history that's been prevalent in the South for a long time. It took shape soon after the defeat of the Confederate States in the war, when Southern historians like Edward Pollard and former Confederate General Jubal Early started preserving the South's perspective through their writings. They framed the Confederate cause as a heroic defense of the Southern way of life against the overwhelming forces in the North. That narrative has a few basic tenets: the glorification of Confederate soldiers who died for a cause they believed in, the belief that slavery was a benevolent institution, and maybe most importantly, that slavery was not the root cause of the war. The Lost Cause is one of the most notoriously effective efforts to rewrite history, and it was done by the losing side. So how did it become so deeply rooted in Southern memory? Blame the United Daughters of the Confederacy. The UDC was founded in Nashville in 1894 to preserve Confederate culture for generations to come. The women who made up the group descended from elite antebellum families, and they used their social and political clout to spread the pro-Southern version of the war as real history. You've probably seen their efforts to honor the Confederacy, but maybe you didn't know it was the UDC. They're the ones who covered the Southern landscape with memorials for Confederate leaders and soldiers. They used their fundraising and lobbying skills to pressure local governments into erecting monuments in prominent public spaces like courthouses and state capitals.
Installed here next to the state capitol by the United Daughters of the Confederacy.
The United Daughters of the Confederacy donated this memorial to the city back in the 30s.
They put them along roadsides and in parks. Any place that was remotely relevant to the Confederacy was memorialized. By the early 20th century, the UDC had 100,000 members and chapters spread all over the country, but mostly in former Confederate states. And there's a reason they grew so quickly during that time.
So we're talking about roughly 3 decades after the end of the war, and the Confederate veterans themselves are beginning to die off. So there is this push to find ways to commemorate it, because the big challenge by 1900 was there's a new generation of white Southerners being born, and they never experienced the war years.
That push is visible. Most of the Confederate monuments were erected during the UDC's height of influence.
There's a rhetoric around monuments that we want to get this thing built before all of that generation has died off. And the reason we want it is to teach future generations about those men.
Dr. Karen Cox wrote the book on the UDC, and I asked her if it was fair to say the group established the Lost Cause as historical fact in the South.
Oh my God, yeah. They were the leaders of the Lost Cause into the 20th century, and they made it a movement about vindication.
Just to give you an idea of how effective they were, they successfully lobbied for a Confederate memorial in Arlington National Cemetery, which U.S. President Woodrow Wilson proudly unveiled to a cheering crowd. Now that's influence, right?
Monuments are the least of what they did.
What?
I mean, they are the most visible and tangible, but the work with children was far more influential.
It turns out a central UDC objective is shaping how children think about the war and their Southern heritage. One of their most powerful tools? Textbooks. Take a look at this pamphlet called A Measuring Rod for Textbooks. It was written by the illustrious Southern historian Miss Mildred Rutherford, an educator, orator, and author of Southern history textbooks. She's also very pro-slavery. The pamphlet announced the formation of a textbook review committee featuring prominent Southerners like 5 former Confederate generals. This group was committed to spreading the truths of Confederate history, so they instructed school boards to reject any textbooks that did not accord full justice to the South. And they urged libraries to deface every book in their collection that didn't measure up by writing the words "unjust to the South" clearly on its cover. This pamphlet was shared widely with school boards throughout the South, and UDC-backed committees closely monitored history books to make sure Northern influence never reached classrooms. So the core language of an approved textbook aligned precisely with that of the Lost Cause. You know, stuff like,
"The Confederacy lost in the war between the states, but Georgia never forgot to honor her Confederate soldiers."
History of Georgia was on the UDC's approved list. It was also written by E. Merton Coulter, a self-described Southern historian and historian-described white supremacist.
They understand that how you educate, who wins the writing game, who wins the battle over history, ultimately wins the war. That's the big fight for the UDC.
But their work with children went further than the classrooms. The UDC formed an auxiliary group called the Children of the Confederacy, which was designed to get kids born in former Confederate states to actively participate in their version of history. Group leaders had kids recite call and response truths from something called the Confederate Catechism. Children up to the age of 18 would compete and be rewarded for memorizing long passages of lost cause rhetoric.
So it would be like an after school thing, you know, like that was your club. You would go after school to the meeting of the Children of the Confederacy, and your leader might teach you songs of the South, like Dixie or other songs that were considered Southern patriotic songs. They would have them write essays, go visit the veterans, and learn this catechism.
Children were also the centerpiece of their community's monument unveilings, like this living flag at the dedication of the Stonewall Jackson Monument in Richmond. Yes, those are school children. The UDC's efforts shaped the identities of children who grew up with the lost cause. They made history personal, and that made their story last longer.
Generations of generations of children learning that narrative in a variety of ways grow up to be, you know, segregationists in the 50s and 60s, because that's been drilled into them since they were children.
After World War I, the UDC started losing steam, but the damage was done. The monuments were in place, and the textbooks they wrote remained in Southern classrooms until the late 70s. And the women's group did it all without the right to vote or participate in politics.
You can still get glimmers of this lost cause memory of the war from people who will always choose to see it through the personal. And I think the UDC, to a great extent, was that was their goal.
So the next time someone says the Confederate monuments are about remembering our history, just know that that's exactly what the United Daughters of the Confederacy wants you to think.
And Vic, earlier this week, the mayor says she gave city council a heads up that the statues would vanish with little to no warning. And just last night, she gave the official order, move them out. Quickly, quietly, and in the pitch black early morning hours, Baltimore's four Confederate monuments came down.
There's enough grandstanding, enough speeches being made, get it done.
The overnight order from Mayor Catherine Pugh green-lighted private contractors to remove the controversial statues. In the dark, she watched as they were loaded onto flatbed trucks bound for somewhere outside of city limits.
You know, I wanted them out of the city, and I would suspect that they're out of the city. I'll find out later on.
Where they are now is a mystery. Previously, the Lee Jackson and the Wyman Dell, the Tiny Monument in Mount Vernon, Confederate women in Bishop Park, and the Confederate soldiers and sailors near Bolton Hill.
I think any city that has Confederate statues are concerned about violence occurring in their city.
Since Saturday's deadly rallies in Charlottesville, two out of the four monuments have been defaced. One graffitied and the other left dripping in red paint, sparking larger concerns of unrest. Earlier this week, City Council voted unanimously to deconstruct the monuments. Learning Wednesday, they're gone.
I don't think having monuments to Confederate traitors is the way to go, so I'm glad to see those statues gone.
And even from the State House, where a Confederate statue still stands, support for the sudden takedown in Baltimore.
I thought that was a good way to handle it.
Kimberly, thank you. WJC Complete Coverage continues now with Jonathan McCall live with reaction to the move. Jonathan.
With tears in her eyes and a tremble in her voice.
I feel that the right thing is being done now.
Amanda Joyce witnesses history, something like many others she thought would never happen.
The fact that it happened overnight, I think, was just wonderful.
A reminder of America's past, no more in Charm City. Overnight, Baltimore City crews removed the city's four Confederate statues, loaded them up on a trip for a new home. We found people today snapping selfies and even making history of their own atop of some of the pedestals.
That didn't offend me at the same level as the others. At the same time, I don't think it's a bad thing that it's gone.
Some families hoping history won't repeat itself used it as a lesson for their kids.
I'm so happy that my daughter don't have to see this when she grow up like I was watching it.
It's never too early to start teaching right from wrong, so they need to know right from wrong. This was a positive day.
People we talked with today say that now that the statues are gone, they're hoping that the conversation here in Baltimore will shift to more social issues, including the education, economy, and criminal justice reform.
Even though we can't forget where we came from, but we don't have to see it.
I think that this breaks down some of the barriers that have kept people apart.
Now, after a 6-1 vote, the DeKalb County Board of Commissioners approved a resolution that could determine the fate of a Confederate monument that stands right in Decatur Square. Channel 2's Audrey Washington reports from DeKalb County, where activist groups say they are now one step closer to getting the Confederate monument removed for good.
After months of debate and protest, a major win for those against the Confederate monument here in Decatur Square.
One step closer.
Tuesday, the DeKalb County Board of Commissioners approved a Confederate monument resolution. That means the commission will now have 30 days to decide what to do with the monument that has stirred so much controversy in the area.
The Civil War was about slavery, that these monuments were erected to celebrate a white supremacist resurrection.
It's about remembrance of the men who fought and died during the Civil War for DeKalb County.
Chris Billingsley says he's a retired Decatur history teacher and supports keeping the monument.
I recreated the march by Southern troops.
After he made public comments before the board, Billingsley talked to me about the Confederate soldiers and their families. There was a tense moment during our interview when one African-American man who wants the monument removed asked, quote, "What about my ancestors? This is what happened next."
Would you like to answer his question?
Thank you very much. I have to go to work.
You talk.
Unlike many of those people in there who want the monument removed, I still work.
Billingsley walked away without further comment. Right now, activists say they'll continue to work towards the removal and focus on the future of the monument.
We hope this sends a message to the rest of Georgia that it's time to remove these monuments.
This is a very positive step forward as we continue to fight and continue to struggle to have this monument removed.
An activist tell me they believe this monument should be put in its historical context, which they believe is in a museum, not here in Decatur Square.
Oklahoma City Public Schools Board voted yesterday to rename three elementary schools named after Confederate generals. The decision is getting mixed reactions. Cassandra Sweetman has the story.
It enlightens me a lot to know that the school is going to be renamed and that change is going to be done.
A decision made by unanimous vote at the school board meeting. Jackson Lee and Stand Wade Elementaries will be renamed in the coming months.
And overwhelmingly, the people I've talked to have said, let's move forward. Let's get this behind us and move down the road and focus on kids and pick a name that better exemplifies our community.
Not everyone. Larry Logan with the Sons of Confederate Veterans spoke up in front of the board, disheartened to see the names possibly changed.
It's not going to diminish those three men. They're wonderful men. It's not going to diminish me for who I am. I'm a proud descendant of a Confederate soldier, and this isn't going to change that.
However, those who supported the effort say they want to see the area's schools named after leaders they don't believe represent hate.
It might make you scared of things right now, because I already know a lot of people are scared of society itself today. So why be scared of the one place where you should be able to be safe, the one place you should be able to learn?
The board looked at costs to change the signage on the schools. Estimates altogether a little more than $40,000. Several board members agree the cost would likely have to fall to private donors.
Then we'll proceed with the process that will hopefully involve parents, students, staff, community members around those schools and Oklahoma City at large to determine what those new names would be.
The renaming process is expected to take at least a year to complete.
To CBS This Morning, the mayor of Lexington, Kentucky, is moving quickly to relocate two Confederate monuments from outside a historic former courthouse. Mayor Jim Gray said the weekend's deadly violence in Charlottesville led him to announce his plans Saturday. Lexington is one of many cities, like Charlottesville, debating the meaning of these Confederate symbols. Michelle Miller is in Lexington and looks at the strong emotions they generate. Michelle, good morning.
Good morning. This is a statue of John C. Breckinridge, a former U.S. vice president and the last Confederate Secretary of War. Now, the mayor wants to remove this statue and another like it, relocated to a nearby park honoring veterans. He knows it's a move that could spark another fiery public debate over what these monuments represent.
The violent clash in Charlottesville, Virginia, is the latest in a series of tense demonstrations over plans to remove Confederate monuments. From New Orleans to San Antonio, communities across the South are taking a critical look at these symbols and, in some cases, are removing them. Lexington, Kentucky Mayor Jim Gray.
Why are mayors across
the country, bringing these statues down now?
Mayors are on the razor's edge. When you see the tension, when you see the violence that we saw in Charlottesville, then you know that we must act.
The Lexington monuments were built near the historic site of one of the country's largest slave auction blocks.
I don't think it's right that we would honor and glorify Confederate men who fought to preserve slavery and honor them on the very grounds that slaves were once sold at auction.
But he's likely to face strong opposition after the city of Charlottesville approved the removal of the statue of Robert E. Lee earlier this year. It was targeted by the Ku Klux Klan and white nationalists. In New Orleans, city leaders faced 2 years of court battles and a handful of violent protests over their plan to remove four Confederate landmarks. The Southern Poverty Law Center has found 1,500 symbols or places that pay homage to Confederate leaders and says there have been at least 100 state and local attempts to remove the monuments or provide more historical context. Some who want the monuments to stay say removing them is erasing an important part of the country's past and see them as landmarks throughout the South.
I think I'll just leave them alone and leave them where they are, you know. They're part of history.
When we place those along the veterans War Memorial Walk, then that story can be told to young people. Hiding that story, erasing that story, that doesn't teach us, but telling the story does.
Keep in mind that Kentucky citizens fought on both sides of the Civil War, which is why the mayor wants Breckinridge statue to stand nearby his Union counterparts. And this is not a done deal yet. The mayor needs the approval of the city council and the Kentucky Military Heritage Commission. Jeff?
Michelle Miller, thank you.
The Confederate statues of John C. Breckinridge and John Hunt Morgan are coming down. The city of Lexington moved in with trucks, cranes, and a heavy police presence tonight to bring them down without warning. This comes after the Urban County Council voted to move the statues last month, but the city was waiting for the Kentucky Heritage Military Commission to rule before taking them down. Angela Reigert was downtown tonight getting reaction from the city and organizers who have been pushing for this change for a long time.
I cannot believe it.
It's an image that brings out a lot of emotion, some happy.
I think it's awesome. I hear people say this is not what democracy is. It's absolutely what democracy is.
Some angry.
This is not the way democracy looks. If I understand the facts properly today, I no longer have any respect for our Attorney General or our mayor.
And for DeBron Thomas and Russell Allen, this is a culmination of years of work.
I don't have any words. I mean, this is what we have worked for, but not only is it just something that we have worked for, it's something that we can prove to the city and to the rest of the people in this community that if you get together, we stand together, you can make change.
Take Back Cheapside has worked with the city of Lexington to discuss a plan for the John C. Breckinridge and John Hunt Morgan statues for years. To some, they're a symbol of racism. To others, an important part of history. That's why the plan is to move the statues to the Lexington Cemetery. It's a plan the vice mayor says will hopefully move forward now that the attorney general issued an opinion saying the Military Heritage Commission does not have jurisdiction.
We hope that now that we have control of the statues ourselves, that we'll be able to work that out, and as soon as that all happens, they'll be moved to the cemetery. I'm presuming that we can work it out.
As crowds stood watching and waiting for the statues to come down, members of Take Back Cheapside say they couldn't help but feel this is how you work together and get things done.
Because it can be done everywhere, and we can stand up and take this statement against these type of statues and what they symbolize.
We're speaking for those who were unable to speak 130 years ago, and my soul is just, I'm just filled with so much pride.
Angela Reigert, WYMT Mountain News.
Mayor Jim Gray also released a statement about the statue's removal. He cited a move by a former mayor for why the Heritage Commission no longer has jurisdiction. The Kentucky Military Heritage Commission has not commented on the situation. We will continue to follow this story as it develops.
The general consensus that whoever spray painted the word racist broke the law, but I want to point something out. Check out behind me here. We're talking about 12 hours after police found this graffiti here at the Jefferson Davis statue. Public Works still hasn't cleaned it up.
I don't know that that is the best way to get our point across.
One word, stopping Richmonders in their tracks.
Well, it definitely is vandalism.
Runners pausing their workouts to snap photos of the big red letters spray painted on the Jefferson Davis statue on Monument Avenue.
It's racist.
Someone in the dark of night graffitied the word racist on the Confederate statue sometime between Monday night and Tuesday morning.
As I said, I agree with the sentiment. I don't necessarily agree with the action.
Hours into the morning, the vandalism remained. Graffiti continuing an ongoing debate whether the five Confederate statues along this historic road should stay or go.
I personally would love to see the monuments come down.
Well, they should stay. Because it's Richmond, it's history. You can't erase history.
The defacing isn't a first for this statue. In 2015, someone spray painted Black Lives Matter here. And last year, a vandal wrote, "Your vote was a hate crime" after the presidential election. If anyone is arrested for this crime, they may face a felony.
We are told by police that they will continue to search for this vandal. Working for you in Richmond, I'm Brennan King, CBS 6 News.
Night in a row, someone has vandalized the Jefferson Davis statue on Monument Avenue. This time the graffiti reads, "Racist, ban KKK." Now you remember this time yesterday morning we were telling you that someone had vandalized the same statue just with the word racist. Police started patrols around the statue every few minutes, but someone came by again just after 11 last night and vandalized the statue again. Police haven't said if they think it's the same person, but they are looking for suspects.
What do you think it's like welded down onto that marble thing?
This second attempt to remove Robert E. Lee and the soldier riding with him started at 3:30 in the afternoon. Under heavy police presence to keep any potential protest at bay, the workers arrived with their company name not on their trucks and their license plates either covered or removed, so they couldn't be identified in the subject of threats like what happened to the first work crew that tried this.
There's no way that can support it.
And in the 4 hours they worked, conversations about history and race and relics of the Civil War were the order of the day behind police lines.
I don't know, I see both sides to it.
Two young women mostly indifferent to the entire political discussion.
I feel like to make everyone happy, don't store it. At least put it in like a museum for people to go and look at it.
Yeah, right.
It's a piece of history, basically. Right. It's U.S. history.
Hey, it's a piece of history. I mean, we need to look at this and learn from it.
While three men talked, insulted by the removal of a tribute to Southern heritage that's been standing in this park since 1936.
I think the funny thing is, in a way, this resurrects old wounds rather than heals them.
I don't think the city has handled this in a very democratic way.
A 74-year-old woman who explained she didn't see what all the fuss was about in the first place.
It's just been a part of my life all my life. And every time I've looked at it, have never once thought about oppression or slavery.
I'm going to enjoy this.
But in the view of an African-American mom and daughter, the removal of a tribute to a Confederate leader and his message was 81 years overdue.
I was feeling kind of like you're unwanted, and it's like, no, we're gonna learn from our past mistakes. And I'm like, feels good. Thoughts up. Oh,
mostly cheers echoed through this park when the statue was finally wrested from its base and loaded onto a trailer for its next trip to a City of Dallas storage facility. No violence, no major protests, just another trip down a Dallas street for a Confederate general.
The end of an era. We'll have to see what the park becomes. And there it goes.
Riding into the sunset while the debate over what his legacy should be.
This isn't what America stands for.
Lives on.
Alabama's attorney general is suing the mayor of Birmingham for covering up a Confederate memorial. That 52-foot monument honoring Southern soldiers and sailors is now surrounded by wooden panels. It is one of many Confederate symbols across the country that could be removed in the wake of the weekend violence in Charlottesville. Some cities are already taking away statues and plaques. Omar Villafranca is in Birmingham at the monument the mayor is targeting. Omar, good morning.
Good morning. This monument was put up in 1905 by the United Daughters of the Confederacy. There's also a new state law that says monuments that have been around for 40 years cannot be removed or altered. And this wall is considered an alteration. Mayor William Bell says he plans to fight the law because he wants this monument pulled down.
We have no real connection with the Civil War, but we are definitely a civil rights city in terms that this was the cradle of the civil rights movement.
Mayor William Bell says Birmingham was founded after the end of the Civil War, and the monument conflicts with the city's deep history in the struggle for civil rights.
You don't want to see it.
No, because again, think about what it represents. The Confederacy was an act of sedition. It was an act of treason.
Tuesday night, he ordered city workers to put up plywood walls around the memorial that has stood here for more than a century. Birmingham is not alone. Baltimore's mayor had four Confederate monuments removed without warning before dawn Wednesday.
I did what was right for my city. That was my intent, and it is done.
Other Confederate monuments are under consideration for removal. Some have been vandalized or even destroyed. At least four people have been arrested in connection to the toppling of that Confederate statue in Durham, North Carolina, Monday night. Mayor Bell says the monument in Birmingham represents something that should have been put to rest a long time ago.
You're a black mayor of a city that was crucial in the civil rights movement.
Yes.
What do you want to happen to that statue?
I would like to see us giving it back to the Daughters of the Confederacy. And if they want to put it on private property, you know, that's their business.
We reached out to the United Daughters of the Confederacy, but did not hear back. Mayor Bell says this statue does not belong in the city that he says broke the back of segregation in America. Charlie?
Thanks, Omar.
Black people were pulled out of their homes. They were mutilated. They were hanged. We had lynching in America. We had acts of community violence perpetrated against African Americans that were just absolutely devastating. So there is this legacy of slavery, and it created a consciousness that black people could be mistreated, could be abused, weren't truly equal. It turned into decades of terrorism and violence.
Police brutality must go!
And that legacy of slavery and the violence and terror that it unearthed is part of what we have to address. I don't think slavery ended in 1865. I think it just evolved. The true evil of American slavery was this narrative of racial difference that we created to justify it. It was the ideology of white supremacy that argued that black people are different than white people, that black people can't do this and they can't do that. They're not fully evolved. They're not fully human. And that's why I continue to believe we're not free. It's created a presumption of dangerousness and guilt that still burdens black people. When lynching finally was moved indoors, it was replaced by a criminal justice system that is just as violent and sometimes just as brutal and unfair. We tolerate targeting and menacing of people of color by our police, by our systems of criminal justice, and that targeting, that menacing, and that tolerance of inequality and injustice has to change.
Don't shoot! Don't shoot! Don't shoot!
We never held people accountable. We have communities where thousands of people gathered to celebrate these acts of violence and torture. If you go to these counties, you won't find markers, you won't find symbols, you won't find statements that address this history. In fact, you'll find the opposite. You'll find totems and iconography celebrating the legacy of the Confederacy, the ideology of white supremacy. Here in Montgomery, Alabama, we intend to open something called the Memorial for Peace and Justice. It will be a 6-acre site that confronts the legacy of lynching in America. We'll have 800 monuments dedicated to every county in this country where lynchings took place. We're going to list the names of over 4,000 African-American victims. In addition to the memorial, we're opening something called the Legacy Museum, from enslavement to mass incarceration. We're building these institutions because we're not afraid to talk honestly about our history. I'm not interested in punishing this country for its history. I want to liberate us. I want something better than fear and anger. And we hope people who visit us in Montgomery will experience that.
Piece by piece, a controversial Confederate monument started to disappear from its spot near U of L's campus.
I'm glad that it's finally happening because it's going to a place that they want it. There are other Civil War mementos, statues in the area where it's going.
A last-minute lawsuit filed by Louisville resident Brennan Callen tried to block the monument's removal, saying the city doesn't own the memorial and that U of L's foundation can't help cover the cost.
The deeds will tell you the ownership, as well as Kentucky Revised Statute 393, the escheat walls, that this property is under the authority of the state treasurer.
A judge disagreed, and crews began removing the statues of Confederate soldiers Saturday. City says it's a careful process to make sure the monument isn't damaged.
We believe that time capsule is in the left-hand corner. So pending that we find that, we will take that to Metro Archives and open it and see what's in it and see if anything survived.
The project costs around $400,000. The city is paying $50,000, and the rest is being covered by the U of L Foundation. The monument will be reassembled in Brandenburg.
The most important thing for the mayor was that the monument will be in a Civil War context in a park that they're developing there.
Some in Louisville hope the issue will finally be put to rest.
They've done the lawsuits, they've done the protests, they've done this, and it, quite frankly, has not generated enough interest.
After the violence in Charlottesville this summer, cities around the country are grappling with history and whether to keep or take down monuments. Last week, the Dallas City Council voted to take down a statue of Robert E. Lee. Just yesterday, protesters covered a statue of Thomas Jefferson at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville. And in New York City, a statue of Christopher Columbus was vandalized in Central Park. Jeffrey Brown recently traveled to Kentucky, a slave state that never joined the Confederacy during the Civil War, but one where the echoes of a divided history continue to be heard.
Louisville, Kentucky, home to the Kentucky Derby.
On Churchill Down, in the heart of the famous bluegrass country.
The Slugger baseball bat. The great Muhammad Ali.
I'm still the greatest of all time.
And for 121 years, until last winter, this 70-foot-tall monument honoring Confederate soldiers. University of Louisville professor Ricky Jones walked past it for 20 years.
I knew what it was, what it represented. Uh-huh. And so when you understand that a symbol like that is something that represents an era of slavery and dehumanization in the country's history, it's demeaning, dehumanizing to walk by it every day if you're an African American.
Today, the statue stands some 40 miles to the southwest in the town of Brandenburg, population 2,600, on the banks of the Ohio River. And Mayor Ronnie Joyner is thrilled to have it.
To me, there's no controversy. I mean, to me, it's a Civil War monument that we have now, and we're proud of it. I mean, you can look at it and see it. It's something that this city can be proud of.
The story of the monument that once stood in this empty traffic median in many ways encapsulates the passions over history and race that are now being fought over in the country. It was given to the city of Louisville in 1895 by the Kentucky Women's Confederate Monument Association. Once on the outskirts of town, it was gradually encircled by the expanding University of Louisville campus. There were earlier protests against it. In 1947, then-Mayor Charles Farnsley responded with a rifle protecting the statue. Then, 2 years ago, following the killing of 9 people in Charleston, South Carolina, by avowed white supremacist Dylan Roof, Professor Jones, head of the Pan-African Studies Department here, started a new effort to remove the statue.
When you really look at the history of these statues, you look at the history of the flag, you look at the history of the Confederacy, which was a treasonous region of the country, you understand that it was steeped in racism. It was steeped in brutality. It was steeped in the idea that one race of people had the right to own, to enslave, to brutalize another. Mm-hmm. Then you can still support the statues. You can still support the flag. You can still support memorials. But you got to be very clear and honest about what you're supporting.
The city joined the effort, helping overcome resistance, including a lawsuit by the Sons of Confederate Veterans. Mayor Greg Fisher says it's part of an ongoing rethinking of the city's past and present, which includes the creation of Freedom Park, not far from the Confederate monument.
So this is explicitly a kind of balance to the statue.
An attempt at that, yeah. So this went up in 2012 by the University of Louisville to say, look, we know not the whole story is being told here with this statue. So let's commemorate some of our powerful figures in terms of African-American leaders in our city here.
The statue says the mayor had no place in modern Louisville.
We're a compassionate city, but there were still some charged emotions. Some people, of course, accused me of erasing history. Some people said, Mayor, you're the Taliban, you're destroying history. I said, no, we're not destroying it, we're just moving it. But
you're moving history?
History is always dynamic. It can always be interpreted in different ways. When this statue was put here over 100 years ago, it was on the edge of a city. 6 months ago, it was in the middle of the city. Very different context. Also, our consciousness as a community, as a country, had changed as well. Clearly, a statue like that was the white order's way of saying, we are still in charge. And what I ask people, would you be okay if somebody came into your house and took your wife away from you, never to be seen again, brutalize her, rape her on the way down the river, separate your family, and then we put up a statue to those people?
But when Louisville decided to take down the monument, Brandenburg welcomed it with fanfare. Ceremony attended by some 400 people. The monument is seen here as part of a history walk along the Riverfront Park, with much smaller statues commemorating Native Americans and the Underground Railroad. And the town has added plaques that purport to tell Civil War history from both a Southern and Northern perspective. Now, says Mayor Joyner, who with Judge Jerry Lynn led the effort to bring it here, it's a Civil War, not a Confederate monument.
It's veterans. I would compare this pretty much to the Vietnam Wall, because this monument, it honors veterans. It wasn't put up to say ha ha ha, you know, we did this. I mean, because the South actually lost the war.
You don't see it as a symbol of slavery, of that?
No, absolutely not. I mean, it's in honor of veterans. It's not. It was never put up to because of slavery or because of black versus white.
But there is a controversy in this country over what some people see as symbols of a Civil War history and of a racial history and a history of slavery and of repression in this country.
I guess there is, but I don't see it that way. And the majority of the people here don't see it that way.
And the mayor says the monument is not going anywhere.
The thing in Charlottesville, I mean, it made news, and so everybody wants to know, what am I going to do? Well, I'm going to do not anything. I mean, I'm going to try to preserve what we have and take care of business.
It was a sentiment we heard from others in Brandenburg, including Jeremiah Cadell, a groundskeeper at a nearby golf course.
Because it represents our history. You know, everybody's wanting to throw it away, sweep it underneath the rug. Nobody wants to hear about it. And then, you know, Brandenburg stepped up and said, hey, we'll take it.
When you say our history, who's us?
Us is African Americans, white, Caucasian people, it's Asian Americans. You know, there's wars fought in overseas.
So what's next? In Brandenburg, Mayor Joyner told me he'd like more monuments, but isn't sure that's possible after the violence that erupted in Charlottesville.
Those propaganda tools.
While in Louisville, the city is holding hearings to decide if other statues should come down.
I'm here to honor John B. Castleman.
The most contentious is John Castleman, a Confederate officer who, after the war, joined the U.S. Army and helped build Louisville's park system. The question now, which aspect of Castleman's life should the city recognize? Last month, the statue was vandalized, splattered in bright orange paint. But when we visited recently, there was another message nearby, save me. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown in Louisville and Brandenburg, Kentucky.
Statue Park welcomes the curious at the edge of town. When regimes fall, so do their monuments. Budapest saved its souvenirs of totalitarianism and shows them off here. Just think of all these statues of Lenin and company crashing to the ground to the cheers of the masses. At Statue Park, you'll see the Communist All-Stars, Marx, local wannabe Stalins, and Lenin in his favorite hailing a cab pose. In a kind of demagogue's hell, they're left with no one to preach to but each other and stony socialist symbols. The heroic soldier, the obedient worker, the tireless mother.
Under Soviet communism, censorship was taken to extremes. Art was only acceptable if it promoted the ideology. The only sanctioned art form in the Eastern Bloc was social realism.
This is social realism. Leaders were portrayed with unquestioned authority. Individuals were idealized as cogs in the machine, strong, stoic, doing their job well and proudly for the good of the nation. Distinguishing features were unimportant. People all looked the same, unquestioning patriots, trusting and serving their nation. These days, with half the local citizenry having no living memory of communism, there's just not much respect. The gift shop offers a tempting parade of communist kitsch. Consider picking up a Red Star lapel pin, a worker's pocket watch, or even a Communist Party vodka flask.
What's the name? This is a fun souvenir, the greatest hits of communism.
Now for some historical context on the South and its Civil War heritage that sparked this weekend's clash. William Brangham has that.
As we reported before, Saturday's violence started originally as a protest by white nationalists over plans to remove a statue of Confederate General Robert E. Lee from downtown Charlottesville. For more on how we continue to struggle with the legacy of the Civil War, we turn to historian and author Edward Ayers. He's written a number of books on the Civil War and the South and spent many years on the faculty at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville. He was also president of the University of Richmond from 2007 to 2015. He joins us from the site of this weekend's violence, where a memorial to victim Heather Heyer has spontaneously appeared. Welcome, Mr. Ayers, to the NewsHour. I wonder, before we get to the past, I wonder if you could just give me your reaction to this week's weekend's events.
Well, for somebody who lived here for 27 years and raised her children here and enjoyed this beautiful small city, it's both heartbreaking and hard to believe.
Obviously, as we had mentioned before, Saturday's protest began by these white nationalists who were protesting the removal, the plans to remove the Robert E. Lee statue. And I wonder if you could just give us a sense, why were these statues, there's hundreds of them all over the country, why were they first erected and who put them up?
Well, as you say, they are all over the country. There are, obviously, the Confederate statues are concentrated in the former states of the Confederacy. Some memorials to fallen Confederate soldiers began immediately after the Civil War, but what we think of as these Confederate statues are really much more a product of the 1890s to World War I period. And so decades go by after the end of the Civil War before this widespread effort to memorialize the Confederacy appears. And you might say, well, why the lag? Well, it's in part because that's when Confederate veterans were dying. And their daughters, United Daughters of the Confederacy, took main responsibility for making sure that they were not forgotten. And so they raised money in small towns and large cities all across the South to put up these memorials to the Confederate soldiers. Sometimes they were grand, such as the one that was put up in Richmond in 1890 that required 10,000 people to pull it by rope up from the James River as it arrived from Europe, all the way to the little solitary soldiers that stand in front of isolated courthouses all across the South.
So how do you suggest that we are to reconcile with this past? Because to many people, they look at the statues like this one in Charlottesville of Robert E. Lee and hundreds others, and they see a monument to men who not only owned slaves, but fought tooth and nail to protect the institution of slavery. What are we to do with that past?
Well, you know, for most of the past that we've had since then, white Southerners had told themselves a story in which slavery did not play a leading role in this, as unlikely as that seems to us now. The story was that men like Robert E. Lee had risen up to fight against a tyrannical federal government that was trying to take away its rights of the states and had fought a valiant cause against much larger forces and had lost, and when they did, laid down their arms in a gentlemanly way. So slavery basically was written out of the story until relatively recently. Looking back on it now, and I think this is not uncorrelated to the controversies over the Confederate flags and the Dylann Roof killing that unleashed a kind of reaction against that, people have been growing to understand, well, of course, even if these individual soldiers were not slaveholders, they were fighting to defend a nation that was based on slavery. And one thing to think about is, forget about for a moment whatever might have motivated these men to have fought. The fact is, had they won, you would have had an independent nation overseeing the largest and most powerful system of slavery in the modern world. So that's one way to think about it. But I think that what these statues tell us is that people remember what they want to remember, and then they see what they want to see.
Do you think that there is a way that we can keep any of these monuments but wrap them in enough context so that a modern audience can appreciate what they stand for? Because there are so many people around the country who now argue, take them all down.
Yeah, I think that there's both of those are, you know, legitimate arguments in different times and places. It is a fact that if people understood why these monuments were put up, when they were, by and who put them up, for what rationale, it could play an instructive role. If people understood that there's not such a thing called history and it never changes and then we just honor it or not, but recognize that every generation is going to see these events of 150 years ago through different eyes. And, you know, through the generations since the Civil Rights Movement, it's harder and harder for the older story of the Confederacy as merely a defense of states' rights against the federal government to stand. But as we've seen, some people want to hold on to that story for their own purposes today. So can the monuments speak to us? Yes, they can. But you have to be very careful about recognizing the story that they tell.
All right, Edward Ayers, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Inside the lawmaking heart of American democracy, a debate about history, race, and identity is playing out. Are historical heroes, some of them slave-owning, treasonous rebels, divisive figures to this day, worthy of honor? The question is being asked in a room so rich in stories, historians like Georgetown University's Chandra Manning feel a bit giddy walking in.
Oh, I get a kick out of being here. Statuary Hall is just so fascinating in how it came to be and what it represents.
The room now known as Statuary Hall was the first House of Representatives. After Congress outgrew the space in the 1860s, the room became a hall of honor. Each state could contribute two statues of deceased citizens, illustrious for their historic renown or for distinguished civic or military services.
When you take them together, what you do have is a statement about who Americans think they are.
And it's not all pretty.
This is Alexander Stevens. Stevens is best known as the vice president of the Confederacy.
And he was racist.
Well, it's hard to say otherwise.
Alexander Stevens owned 34 slaves and several thousand acres in Georgia, famous for his 1861 speech outlining the reason for the Confederacy. He said its cornerstone rests upon the great truth that the Negro is not equal to the white man, that slavery, subordination to the superior race, is his natural and normal condition.
Here is a man who said that the fit station for African Americans, as we would say now, is enslavement.
Yes.
And school children, African American, all races, walk through and see him.
And see him there, yes.
There are 12 statues of Confederates in Statuary Hall and other parts of Capitol Hill. The state of Virginia supplied this statue of Confederate General Robert E. Lee even before it submitted one of that state's most prominent politician, first president of the United States, George Washington. Just as telling as who the states chose is when they made those choices.
That they would choose particular exemplars at a particular time makes it very difficult to stop short of the conclusion that the choice is very directly linked to a strong message about who counts and who should stay in their place.
Lee donated in 1909, just as laws mandating segregation were passed. Stevens donated in 1927, just as the Ku Klux Klan soared in popularity not just in the South, but across the U.S., followed shortly by this statue.
Jefferson Davis, a gift of the state of Mississippi in 1931. Jefferson Davis is most well known, of course, for serving as the president of the Confederacy.
A rebel, essentially.
Oh, certainly.
Treasonous.
Certainly. To try to overthrow the government of the United States by armed force is a rebel at best and treason at worst. And yet, here he is.
It gives me pause that this is not the place for an individual like him. I see Statuary Hall as a place of honor, as a place where one would come to look at the true heroes of America.
Congressman Benny Thompson, a Democrat, has represented Mississippi's 2nd District for 27 years. He supports legislation recently introduced by African American Democrats in the House and Senate to remove Confederate statues from the Capitol. But he doesn't think it will pass. Not yet.
A lot of people are saying, you know, it really doesn't make sense to put these statues of men associated with the Ku Klux Klan, with slavery and other dastardly deeds, in places of honor. Because what they did was illegal, treasonous, And as I say, criminal.
Republican House Speaker Paul Ryan said in August it should be up to states to decide which statues they want, so it's unlikely the bill will get very far. And recent polls suggest more than half of the American population believes that Confederate monuments should stay in public places. Lindsay Duncombe, CBC News, Washington.
We're having, once again, for whatever it is, the 17th time, a major racial reckoning in America, and we don't know exactly where this one's going.
According to Yale University Civil War historian David Blight, most early Confederate monuments were part of an effort to recast the secessionist cause as a noble one, one that supposedly had little to do with maintaining slavery. But simply adding statues of African-American icons isn't a solution, says Brian Stevenson. He still remembers what it felt like seeing Confederate monuments as a kid.
I always thought, despite the fact that they were copper or bronze, that they were screaming at me. They were saying, I don't belong here. This is not your land. You are still subordinate.
Stevenson, founder of the Equal Justice Initiative in Montgomery, Alabama, is turning a light on one of America's darkest post-Civil War chapters, the nearly 4,000 documented lynchings that happened in the Old South between 1877 and 1950. He's not worried if it makes some people uncomfortable.
I do think that we need to increase the shame quotient in America. I don't think shame is a bad thing. I think it actually moves you and pushes you to think differently about things. And I don't frankly think we've expressed our shame about slavery. I want us to talk about what it means to honor someone who did something dishonorable,